Yes, sir. Before I begin, I request except the speaker to everyone request everyone to mute themselves, please, because I'm getting a lot of background noise. Mr. Dipankar Banerjee, sir, could you please mute? Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Good morning, one and all. I take this opportunity to warmly welcome you all to the C3S Institutional Dialogue on the topic China's Multi-Domain Warfare by Lieutenant General Shankar, sir. Before I begin my introduction of the topic, may I request Commodore Vasan, sir, to give the opening remarks, please.
Thank you, Bala. I think all the participants have already heard so much from me. There is little scope for me to say something more. But this is more with reference to the topic that is on hand. Those of you who have been following this blog, the Gunner Shot, would have already known the kind of depth of knowledge that General Shankar brings to the table. So from that point of view, what we're going to discuss today will be of vital importance in understanding the Chinese psyche, the methodology that they adopt for dealing with their adversaries, neighbors, friends, whoever. You know, there is that kind of an approach which is there, whether it is in South China Sea, you know, where they use a particular pattern, and whether it's the trans-Himalayan aggression that we have encountered, nothing has stopped there. And in fact, we are in there for a very long haul. So there you came across these reports of loudspeakers playing Bollywood and Punjabi songs. So that's also one method of fighting for them. And 3 days ago, you saw a report where they have made a lot of advances in what I would call genetically modified bio soldiers. You know, because this is another thing which where, you know, they apparently, there's a lot of report that has come out to say that they're investing heavily in genetically modify a soldier and, you know, make him fatigue. It is like some of the Hollywood movies that you have seen. So here is where fiction becomes science. So that's the other one. So there's the psyops which are taking place through their media, you know, which is well integrated. It's like Global Times or Genoa or People's Daily, the kind of warfare that they launch. Or what they do in diplomatic missions in Australia. They barge into a meeting and, you know, the Chinese diplomat tries to take charge of the Australian people. All these are methods of warfare. So they have followed Sun Tzu mostly, but at times recklessly, as was indicated during the COVID. So here again, apparently, I quoted this before, where they said, when the neighbor's house is on fire, loot it. So that's a Chinese program. I'm sure Mr. L.V. Krishnan, Asma, and others will try and look at how it is said in Chinese. But apparently, this is what they believe in. So this is the neighbor that we have to deal with. And only when we understand the extent to which the complete government machinery or the so-called private machinery in China is geared up to deal with their adversaries. You know, you saw what happened in South China Sea. You know, they are using both the RCEP as well as the code of conduct to put pressure on them. Now they will also lure the ASEAN countries to say that we'll come and invest in you, and the RCEP will enable you to export, etc. So all these are one way or other can be classified as means of warfare. You know, you call it hybrid warfare, you call it new warfare, you call it the new norm, whatever you want to call it, this is what it will be. So without taking too much of time, I have some more points, but it's General Shankar's talk and not mine. So I'll request General Shankar, who's already been introduced, to handle this topic. So you can take about 20 minutes or so that there's enough time from the participants to pose your questions. So what you not covered in the talk could be taken up during the Q&A. With that, over to you, General Shankar, all yours. 20 minutes for you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for that nice introduction. I think you put across a lot of important points there. At the outset, it's a pleasure for me to be with all of you, ladies and gentlemen, who taken time off on a Sunday morning to listen to what I have said. It's also a great honor for me to join the Chennai Center for China Studies. And I would like to say, I would contribute what my two-bit worth is. But to give you a basic background of where I come from and why I have this enduring interest in China, my first posting way back in 1977 was to Sikkim in along the Nathula area and, you know, those areas, Jalapla, Nathula. And from then I've had n number of postings to along the LAC, right from, and I've seen the LAC right from the Karakoram Pass to Kibitu almost at every place, and have had postings at various this thing. As part of that, I did a lot of study on China. In fact, my knowledge of Pakistan is relatively less than China as compared to a normal army officer. It is with this that, I've been writing, but I've not been in any China-oriented think tank or XYZ for the simple reason that I had to modernize artillery. That was a great challenge for me. What was not done for good about 20, 30 years, we managed to do over a period of one decade. In fact, later in the day, I'm going into a seminar which is examining successes of India in modernization. And one of the successes which I'm going to present there is how artillery succeeded. So I spent my time there. Now, after having come and retired and settled in Chennai, and started off back with the IIT Madras with technology, I said, let me devote some time for China and put my effort into how to handle China. So I've written a whole lot of articles. This subject, which we are talking of, multi-domain warfare of China, is one article, right? It gives you a Chinese perspective, like what the said. It is nothing. We need to understand China to know how to handle it better. It is like Mr. Raghavan said, it is just another country from my side, and it's not. There's too much being made out of it. So with this, I'll get into the formal presentation mode. I hope you can all see my screen.
Yes, sir. It's presenting, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. Can you see the slide, please?
Yes, sir. Can you make it presentation?
Yeah, I'll do that. Right.
Perfect, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. This is nice. At the outset, again, thank you for calling me over and for this institutional dialogue. I do see some of my friends from outside Chennai also in this. It's great to have you on this panel, and I generally see General Rajan Kocher, who was one of my commanders when I was in command of the area. Thank you, Rajan, to be here. Right, when you look at China today, what's happening around India, how China is, you look at it from Pakistan. Pakistan is its all-weather friend. CPEC is actually a multi-domain system which they're constructing. They've gone into Daimar Basha Dam, which has been inked a few days back. And this Daimar Basha Dam is going to come right bang in Gilgit-Baltistan. IWYs, China and Pakistan are collaborating in a big manner. We know about their collusion, and the defense minister recently visited China. Look at Nepal. Again, the defense minister visited there. They instigated Nepal to take up the Kalapani issue along with their encroachments 6 months back. And they've been making big inroads in Nepal, in their culture and everything. And there is also talk that some Nepalese Gurkhas could go into the PLA. But we'll see how that goes. As far as Bhutan is concerned, they've laid claim on Sakteng. If you know where Sakteng is, it actually outflanks Faidel. It is 100 kilometers within the Nepal, India, Sino-Bhutan border. How they've claimed, we don't know. And they've made now, they've gone into Doklam. Actually, that encroachment in Doklam, which is today in the news, is something which they did in 2017. But now they're publicizing it, public opinion is shaping in a manner as if it's a fresh encroachment and they're going to go down to the plains of India. Well, the problem is there, but the problem is not now. It has been there for quite some time. And this story has been picked up by New York Times and Washington Post and of course all our news channels and everything. It's been made a big deal. Come to Myanmar, they're progressing and pushing Myanmar into the CMAC, construction of the Mitsone Dam, that port facility at Kaikafu. So there's a whole lot of things that they're doing besides just, defense issues. Then, the defense minister, when he visited, he went to Bangladesh also. And Bangladesh is now totally enmeshed in China, with China for the BRI, right? And there are more issues, but I'll take it up later. And then, of course, we all know about the debt trap. And they put Sri Lanka in with Hambantota, and now they're going in for the Colombo port. They're looking at a base in Maldives. They want an island in lieu of the money they've invested. And they want, of course, make inroads in IOR. This is the kind of activities which they're doing against others. For against us, we know Eastern Ladakh. They're now trying to build that dam at where the Tsangpo or the Brahmaputra enters India, just north of Kepangla, right? And then they're entering IOR. They've invaded the apps here in a big manner. Their balance of trade is with them heavily. Now it's, of course, this thing. You have a Chinese ambassador here who passes diktat to our press as if he's a bloody king of England. And what's surprising, they've also entered, the CCP has entered MOU with Congress. They've done it very sharply, very farsightedly, and they've actually decapitated the Congress party to a large extent with this MOU, because the public will not, go with the Congress party. Whether Congress is in power or not is a different thing, but it's a long player. Now, this is just to give you a flavor of what it is. Now, we will get into what is happening today. There's a huge disruption in military affairs which is going on. This disruption in military affairs is something I've spoken about in the strategy, defense and strategy seminar of the ARTRAC. And I'm repeating it to some extent here. There are three aspects to this disruption in military affairs. The first aspect is the multi-domain wars, which I'm going to speak of, is reference to China specifically. Simultaneously, there is a whole lot of disruptive technologies which are disrupting military affairs. And there's a new thing, or I won't say a new thing which we need to focus on. It's called military-civil fusion. And I'll touch upon all these three. Now, but before I get into that, we need to understand there's an ideological disruption going on. And that ideological, as far as Pakistan is concerned, is radicalized Islam. I mean, it's radicalized Islam, which is eating Pakistan itself. And China is hardcore communism. Just a few days back, there's a report of the intelligence chief of USA where he said, hardcore communism is the biggest problem the world is going to face in the next decade. Right? Now, the fact which we have to understand, ideology cannot be defected kinetically. So, what is the ideology you have? Are you looking at democracy, pluralism, religion and culture? What is the subtext of the armed forces? What is the subtext of India? These are issues which we need to really consider. Because we have come up with a communist system which is matured and hardened, which is not going to break so easily. And we need to understand what they're doing. Now, simultaneously, there's a revolution in military affairs which went on from the Gulf Wars. But all these disruptive technologies which I've highlighted in the center are leading to disruption in military affairs technologically. So there's an ideological disruption, there's a technological disruption, which is important. And this is something which China is leveraging very smartly. Okay, now we'll look at multi-domain warfare proper. The whole business of multi-domain warfare started off with two Chinese colonels writing this book called Unrestricted Warfare in the turn of the century, which they have, they actually employing it. They refined this and had a second edition come out, right? And both these guys are part of one of their premier think tanks, and they guide how China is behaving. Now, as a reflex to this, the Americans have started the American army started this with something called multi-domain operations. When I read both of these together, I felt there's something called the multi-domain warfare, which is a bigger overarching thing which is going on. And ever since then, I have written articles on this and I have studied, written this. There's really no authenticated thing of what I'm going to speak on. There's no pre literature on this business of multi-domain warfare. Okay, what is this multi-domain warfare all about? When you look at it, there are multiple domains, right? But let's look at the outer circle first, and then we'll come into the inner one. War is going to be fought. It's not in an area of war and in peace. So it's going to be across the spectrum of war and peace, day and night, right? The actors who are going to be in this business of war and peace and no war, no peace, hot war, cold peace, hot peace, all this nonsense, are state, non-state, and state-sponsored. There could be NGOs, MNCs. In the case of China, it could well be their private companies. What is emerging is most of their private companies are being controlled by the government. The means could be hard and soft power. It could be conventional and non-conventional. Right. Now, let us now look at the domains. And I'll explain each domain. The conventional domains which we all thought of were air, land, and sea. And we were happy fighting through this. Slowly, space came up. Cyberspace also came up. Now, as these domains started building up, they started acquiring individuality about themselves through which you can fight and you can affect the other guy, right? Then the nuclear domain came up. Just to give you an idea, you know, yesterday, 2 days back, I read an article about the Chinese artificial sun based on fusion energy coming up, right? They're now exploiting this nuclear domain. Okay. So, and I went into it and I found, look, there's nothing new. They're doing something different from, they're doing nothing different. This is a thing which they've been doing. So have we been doing. So has France been doing. So has, USA been doing. So I had to put out an article on it. But this is something which they're fighting through. Then the electromagnetic spectrum, they have exploited in a huge manner. Energy and supplies. Tomorrow's game. Energy and supply is all what China's, one of the main planks of warfare. The BRI, if you look at it, is the whole story of BRI is only about energy and supplies and resources. Right? They're exporting coal-based energy systems, gaining control with politics and ideology. And everything is interconnected, but we'll go into it in a little bit later. Diplomacy. We just heard someone say, look, how the Chinese diplomats have been behaving in Australia. Economy. Economy, they weaponized in a big manner that no one has any doubts about it. The three war strategy, public opinion, legal, and influence, we'll dwell on it in a little greater detail. Right. Now, when you look at the conventional domains of air, land, and sea, there is a direct attack, conventional aggression through air, land, and sea in Ladakh and South China Sea, which they've exhibited. And they're prepared to exhibit it anywhere else. And they're already, Xi Jinping has said, PLA will be the greatest military force in 2027. Of course, there are a lot of issues to it. I don't believe it, right? It can't happen that the force which was to be fully modern by 2050 can become modern by 2027, 7 years hence, right? All they can do is get into a seven-year itch. But they use the conventional domains to get indirectly at us through Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan, which we saw. Pakistan and Nepal are virtual cat's paws, which we all these things have discussed. So, this is how they're exploiting the conventional domain, direct and indirectly. Now, let's look at the disruptive technology domains. Look at space. Space technology for them is an investment. There's a search for liquid hydrogen and helium to power fuel cells and attain energy dominance. Tomorrow, in an area of depleting resources, lesser dependence on fuel, fossil fuels and all that, whoever has got the energy will dominate. That's the superpower. I mean, if you read today's article which I put out, you'll see that India is there, well up there. And if we can leverage everything, we're going to be one of the next great powers of this earth, without doubt. Then there's a quest for new materials. all these rare earth materials. You go for asteroid mining, they're looking at asteroid mining for rare earths, and China is in it in a big way. And whoever is going to get those rare earths will rule the roost, as China is doing it with what they have today. Then they have a vibrant military and civilian aerospace ecology, which is an enterprise activity in a huge manner. Then there are satellite and anti-satellite technologies which are coming up, right? Whether it's for energy or for direct energy weapons and what have you, right? Space is being exploited. Okay. Now, when I say space is being exploited, it is not exclusive to China. Please understand, this is a domain which China is exploiting like others. Okay. If you looked at it in Ladakh, they projected through space their map around finger 4 and finger 5. They're exploiting space in concert with other domains, right, to get their point of view across. So they're weaponizing all these. Sorry. When you look at cyberspace and electromagnetic spectrum, both these are interactive and interdependent domains. We know they've carried out a hell of a lot of cyber attacks against India, USA, and Australia. In fact, the maximum cyber attacks which have been carried out in the past 1 year have been by China. I'll not get into the figures, but it is so. We all know it, right? Now, with cyberspace and electromagnetic spectrum, AI, communication, and IC technology through MCF, military-civil fusion, have been combined. Now, this is insidious, right? They're looking at Huawei is a prime example of this. They're looking at profits. They're looking at control of governments through communication, social media surveillance, intelligence collection, and data collection. It's all rolled into one. I mean, they're so ingenious in this that we never thought of it. What they're thinking, the way they're going about it. At the same time, they've copied and refined these technologies or these ideas from USA and UK. Now, these two key domains underpin Chinese domination in other domains. So, if you look at the economy, if you look at anything, you will see this business of ICT coming up to the fore, cyberspace coming up to the fore. You will see electromagnetic spectrum coming to the fore. Then the nuclear domain. Nuclear domain is no more confined to nuclear war. It is proliferation for geopolitical control, whether it's through Pakistan, North Korea, and now probably they'll do it through Iran. They're looking at nuclear grouping also. Their use and denial of nuclear energy. They're trying to keep us down. They're not allowing us to get into the nuclear supply group. All this has got a long-range effect. You denied nuclear energy, you can't go ahead in the thorium route. Thorium route gives you total energy independence from almost everyone tomorrow. And India is the leader in the thorium technology. That combined with the space technology which we have and our ability to reach Mars and Moon puts us as a direct competitor to China. So China will use this nuclear route to keep us down. Right? That's what I've written all. Right? Okay. So this is very important and we need to be cognizant of this. Look, let's look at the traditional domain. When China was isolated and poor, it was always troublesome and expansionist, even then, when Mao was there. Today, it is rich and ambitious. It's even more so. Right? And yesterday, I read a report of EU, the Secretary General, he said that China is going to be the biggest problem for EU and democracies. And we need to be cognizant of this. It's not as if we don't know. I've just codified it and put it in some organized form. Look at the political domain, whether it's political bullying, threatening, or coercion, they're doing it. Go back to 2014. PLA intruded into, you know, the Sumer area when Xi Jinping was visiting India, and they were, you know, Prime Minister Modi and Xi Jinping were on a Jula mode. We all thought that PLA was acting independently. No, we didn't read it. It was a premeditated, hostile political move. By then, Xi Jinping had full control over PLA. It was giving us a message. Today's military aggression, or in South China Sea, or in Hong Kong, these are all planned political moves. They're not military moves. If you see, analyze this whole story, they've never got into tactical mode except after we occupied the Kailash Range. Right? So, till then, it was political posturing. Now, look at economy. Economy, they've weaponized economy beautifully. They've ensured that countries are intertwined and dependent on them through the BRI. How does it work? If 60, 70 countries are with the BRI, a little more than that, and they're all intertwined and in debt traps, they're forcing all these countries to vote for them in the UN. UN, which has got about 190 countries, right? You need to get about 80 to 85 countries to get a majority vote and put your resolutions through and put your point of view through. If 70 of your votes are through BRI and the grip which BRI has on these countries, you just need to get another 20, 30 votes. Now, to in a balance of 120 votes, where it's a democratic system, there will be as it is normal democratic difference, and those 20, 30 votes will come. So, anyway you look at it, future, through BRI, they're going to control UN and world bodies. Right? They're making us defer to their political requirement. They're undermining the international financial system through this. Today, I just read that they are already looking at having a digital yuan to make it into an international system of exchange. I have no problem with yuan becoming an international system of exchange. But with that, they're going to control us. The digital yuan is going to be so intrusive in our lives, we're going to have problems. Of course, debt trapping, we know. And we also know that how dependent we are commercially on China, and it can be weaponized any day. If they're not doing it, it is for different reasons. Right? It's not just for our markets. Then they're going to break, if they break relations with that, they've got problems. That's why you'll see that the way China has behaved with us, despite all this, is far different. Well, but then we'll come to that later. We've heard of diplomacy, wolf warrior diplomacy. We spoke of how they've been behaving in Australia. They've been capturing international aggressions, as I said. They've targeted country sovereignty unambiguously, whether it's in Australia or France. Okay, energy and resource exploitation. Mineral oil, mineral and oil resources from Africa and South America through BRI and debt traps. I've spoken about it. Now they're using water as a weapon, whether it's for Indus or Brahmaputra or Mekong. They've already got all the countries on the lower riparian of the Mekong in their grip. Laos, Cambodia, Thailand, everyone is in trouble. Vietnam, because they started controlling the Mekong. Indus, we already had problems with them on Satluj. Right? And now, once they build a dam on Sangpo, on Brahmaputra, they're going to control us. So, water, they're weaponized already. And we need to do something about it. But that's a different story, because today's, I'm going to talk only about what China is doing. Now, this is a dicey domain. I call it the dark power domains and the three war strategies. It is the exploitation of the power of information and data in a continuum. I said the electromagnetic spectrum and their cyber domains are underpinning domains for this. They use it here. Political intent is conveyed through these domains.
I think by mistake he has locked off. He should be joining in shortly.
Well, I can just call up and check if there's any issue with him.
Yes, sir. I'm just checking, calling him, sir. He's joining in shortly, sir.
Okay, got that.
What has happened?
I think by mistake he has just ticked the log off button, sir.
Technical error.
Yeah.
There is a glitch, is there?
No, sir. I think by mistake he has just clicked the instead of changing the slides, he has clicked the log out button, sir.
Correct.
I will be back, sir. Just give him another couple of minutes. He'll be back.
Yes, sir, I just called him, sir. He's just joining in shortly, sir.
Oh, sorry. Can you hear me?
Yes,
are you audible? Please go ahead. Welcome back.
Yeah. Sorry. That was because my internet here became unstable. So I have now put it on my mobile as a hotspot. So I'll get back to my presentation. Where did this whole thing break?
Chinese cyber attack.
The dark okay. domains, sir.
Thanks. Same. I'll get back there.
According to the dark domains.
Right. Yeah, thank you, sir. Yeah, so we are covering the dark power domains and you know all this. And public opinion. If you look at it today, virtually the farmers agitation has been taken over by Pakistan and China through Canada. And they a little doing it. That's going to take Right.
General Shankar, your audio is cutting off. There is interruption in your audio. The slides are okay.
And just look at it. Oh. Okay.
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Can you hear me now, sir? Problem in this area.
No, we can hear you. We can hear you now. Please go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah, Shanks, we can hear you. We can
hear. Thank you, sir. Right.
Yep, you're getting in.
Right. Now, you know, I was talking of shaping domestic and international public opinion through media, military expert, and political parties. We know all this, but look at this. I mean, like I said earlier, they've already compromised the Congress party. Whatever you want to do today, till that MOU with Congress party is there, every time you think of China, you think of this Congress party. And that's not good for our democracy, right? And the way their media experts, in fact, I feel that, you know, they've also invaded the media experts and the military experts in the Western societies. So, like what was said earlier, the Western narrative also is being controlled by them. So, what China thinks about India might be coming to you through the Western societies, right? Then, of course, the halo building to project invincibility, genetic modification of soldiers, their artificial sun. There talk of putting space stations up in the sky. All these things which they're doing, and they're also trying to say we're going to manipulate the weather systems for rain, which is going to affect India. All this is halo building. They had built a halo that PLA is invincible, but we broke it. So this is a very dangerous thing which they're using. Then, of course, the legal status. They've always portrayed themselves as the victim. Even now, they're trying to portray us as the victim. they are trying to portray themselves as the victim for the virus and say it's originated, sometimes they say in India, sometimes in Italy, and sometimes in USA. All the stories they do, they have been violating international rules-based order, right? Their legal justification is through mythical history, because some joker came here, that this is part of their thing, right? And they get on to accusing others of breaking rules. They exploit legal loopholes of democracies. All democracies are today susceptible to this problem. And this is being recognized internationally. This is not Shankar's invention. In fact, if you read the Secretary General of EU, his report, which I read today, Jens Stoltenberg, all this he talks of. Now, they target countries which have left no choice but to accept the Chinese fait accompli, like they did with Sri Lanka. Or they've done with Laos or with Cambodia. Now, influence operations. Now, these narratives are being built through planned politicians, media, and officials. I mean, can you imagine the Harvard, one of their departments, one of the chairs of the departments was being given $50,000 annually to put up across the Chinese narrative. That's the kind of penetration they've done to influence their narratives. Their think tanks, academic institutions, workers' unions, industry, government, they're all penetrated. For all you know, some of us have been penetrated heavily. I mean, they're experts at it. If you're going to have a one-to-one relationship with a Chinese think tank, be sure he's trying to penetrate you as much as you're penetrating him. But he's better funded, so he'll penetrate you more. Okay. And they're going to exploit our plurality and fissures in our political and bureaucratic firmaments. We must remember that notwithstanding that we have a rightist government today, we are still a socialist country. It's there in our constitution. Right? And of course, China will endeavor and ensure that either a wrong decision is taken or one that favors them is taken. Right. Health, I don't have to say. The way they've weaponized this virus is not funny. They've gone into mass diplomacy, old story. Today it is the vaccine diplomacy. They're garnering people by vaccines. They're using, through vaccine and this virus, they started this health Silk Road. And this is an alternate to the BRI, which is failing. So, I mean, they'll do anything. Right, now I'll spend a little time on civil military fusion and tell you what they're doing. Right, the colonial birth system actually gave birth to this military-civil fusion. It was refined by USA when their shipbuilding and internet, all this part of civil-military fusion in the last century. That's how China became a superpower. Now, USA became a superpower in the last century. But China is taking it to a sinister level. Now, as per documents, as per US Western documents, and there is evidence to say so, China aims to convert PLA into a technologically advanced military by 2049. Only thing is, last week, Xi Jinping says it 2027. But that's a different story. You look at it, Huawei is absolute civil-military fusion. Daimar Bhasha Dam is absolute civil-military fusion. They're building a dam in Pakistan, in Gilgit and Baltistan, which gives multiple options for China and Pakistan to enter either Ladakh or Kashmir or Kargil, right? It also sanctifies Chinese presence for the next 10 years because that's the time period of this dam being built. So there's a huge issues in this military-civil fusion which we need to be aware of. Yeah, this is it. This is where the Daimar Bhasha Dam is going to come. And 10 years from today, they're going to be there. This is CPEC, right? So if China is centered around here and Chinese people are going to be hanging around with infrastructure building, they'll build infrastructure to Kargil and to Ladakh, and then they'll do this business of collusive action. They are already sitting here and they'll start action from here. So there's a problem. We need to understand this. What is the structure? The civil military fusion structure is the CCP is at the apex of the military civil fusion. It's a CCP. The Troika underneath is the government, PLA and civilian firms. These are meshed seamlessly. We know it. Our government, luckily, I mean, full credit to our government and to Mr. Modi. I'm talking apolitically. We recognize this. So, keeping them out of contracts, banning their apps has got a lot of value. It's got strategic value. It's not commercial value. This is what we're going to break. Right? They friend each other interchangeably. And of course, America and the West are recognizing today. The Germans recognized it long back because they were the first guys who were coerced into parting with technology. Right? Now, like I said, they don't have any barriers between civil, military, industry or government and non-government. Look at it. Just about a month back, they pulled down the IPO of the Ant Group, that is Jack Ma, because they didn't like it, because it was going out of their control. So that China is going to control their civil system and actually going to weaponize it. Okay. Right. The state-owned enterprises and financial system are the main actors. 20 years back when I was reading China, the state-owned enterprises were like our public sector undertakings and OFB, ready to be sold off. They used to be called the rust buckets. But today, they are the prima donnas. I mean, we have to be clear about all these things where China is going to hit us. What are their methodologies? The military-civil fusion focuses on dual-use technologies like quantum computing. They already come out with it. Again, last 1 week, they've been on a hyperdrive for all these technologies to show technological superiority, that they've got they are already up there in quantum computing. Big data, semiconductors, 5G, nuclear technology, which I have spoken of. In fact, today's article on artificial sun, have a look at it. Aerospace technology and AI. Technologies are developed or acquired legally or illegally. This is known. Like I said, they subterfuged or subverted Harvard, which is the holy grail of intellectual property in USA. Their methods, investment in private industry, talent recruitment programs, academic and research collaboration, forced technology transfer, I spoke of it, intelligence gathering and outright theft. State financing and subsidies are huge. Land is free of cost for any industrial activity. So they'll put you out of business because he can come with much lesser costs. It's not so with us. Then which are the core dual use which they're looking at? They're looking at artificial intelligence, new materials, energy storage, communication and nuclear power. These are their core issues which they're looking at. When you look at all this, you have to be very clear. Whenever they're part of an international society to develop all this, they're aiming to thieve it and go back. That's the fundamental. Right? Okay. So I get back to that. You put what all I have said earlier and put it in this dimension, you're not going to be attacked just one-dimensionally. It's going to be a multi-diamond, multi-domain affair which is going to come against you. We need to recognize that. And we need to respond accordingly. It's not that we can't. And I've been writing on how it is. And I have one fundamental thing. If you look at it, one antidote for China, this is my next article I'm going to write, is that China has been externalizing hugely because of the fact internally they're stable. Artificially or naturally is a different story. They're stable. So you have to make China unstable and make them look inward. And I think that is something which Mr. Trump recognized when he started his issue with Tibet. Make China look inward. And then things will fall in place. And I think that's what we have to do. And we have to get our act together with USA, without USA, with EU, whoever, Australia, Quad. Say what you have to. Start making China look inwards. And be aware that they're going to carry out a multi-domain operation. With this, I'll stop and we can get into a discussion. For any questions you have, I'll be more than willing to have. 1 minute.
Yes.
Hold on, Aishwarya. Yeah, hold on, Aishwarya, 1 second.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. All questions, of course, have already been put in the chat box. If there are any more, they should also be put in the chat box, because nobody will be allowed to speak here. It takes a lot of time.
So
can you hear me?
Yeah. All right. I can't hear you too well, sir.
All right, okay. So,
Bala, I think everyone has to put their things off.
Sir?
Yes, sir.
I'll also put my video off, because the bandwidth otherwise is too poor. Yeah. My area, I think, is badly affected.
All right. Bala, please mute everybody else except the speaker. Okay. First of all, I would like to thank General Shankar for this outstanding talk on multidimensional warfare, the military-civil fusion or whatever. What he's brought out clearly is that first you are going to address your security issues, whether it's energy security, health security, military security, food security, water security, UN security, you know, which he also mentioned, you know, has been ensured by buying out these people, technological security. So once you have all this security, you find that you are on a better wicket to challenge others, which is what it's been doing. So those points have come out very clearly. So obviously this is war by all other means. So you're not going to have to necessarily go in a conventional manner and challenge your adversary on the land or in the air or over the seas, but challenge them otherwise, which is what's been trying and which has been fairly successful. It's unfortunate that we did not read the signals in the past. You know, everyone encouraged China with the hope that they will integrate better in an international system, whether it's WTO or UN or wherever. But obviously, all those hopes have been belied, and it's perhaps become a little too late for others to realize as to the rose garden through which China led others. So from that point of view, the talk that's given by our soldier scholar, not only has he got firsthand experience of the field in the army, but he is also now a professor. Therefore, he's been able to beautifully blend the theoretical aspects of this, theorize what is happening here, and then bring it down to the issues of ground reality, which we are confronted with. So unless we are very clear of the big game, we'll not be able to take off. And of course, in many of the articles that General Shankar has written, he's also told us as to how we can take on China, which seems to have an edge. But it's on the ground when you analyze it, it's not so. So here is where, you know, it's a question of alliances that are important. He mentioned this. So if you cannot do it, and I've always been saying in all our discussions within, that what you cannot do alone, you have to do by alliance of the like-minded. That's the only way out. You can't do it alone. Let's not think that we can take on China all by ourselves. You know, with an economy, this is 1/5 the size of China. There is no way we can take on China today. Let's face it. And therefore, you have to build up those alliances, which will give you a combined advantage by coalition. That's the only. So with this, I will ask Aishwarya to take on the questions and read them out for General Shankar. And General Shankar, if his system is okay, can also kindly look at the chat box, and so that you can also already ready with your answers and responses. And no questions will be taken up here on the mic by speakers. All that will be only in the chat box. Aishwarya, please route them through.
Thank you, sir. This is Shivani Sundar. We'll go to the question and answer section now. There are so many questions, sir. Shall I read it for you one by one or together?
Anyway.
I would recommend that you put them all together so that General Shankar can make a note of this and respond together. Otherwise, we'll waste a lot of time. Would recommend that you read all of them together. So he makes a note, and whatever is to be responded together, you club them together in terms of response.
All right, sir. So Mr. Ateria, he has asked, is China communist or fascist? Abin Basant has asked, in future, instead of hand-to-hand combat, might be entire different strategy. How could it be if a bio war, will it cope up or prevent it? Then we have the third question, Rajaram Muthukrishnan, sir. The blurring lines and the emergence of integrated hybrid warfare as a model of the future with perpetual war on many fronts. Do you think the civil, military, technology, political leadership in India is ready for this era? Sir, do you think you... There are a few more. Should I just stop now? You'll answer it.
Go ahead.
All right. Yeah. Okay, sir. All right.
Whatever General Shankar decides, I'm quite okay with whatever format he chooses.
All right, sir. Then fourth question, Amrita Shah. There is clear information that China created fighter aircrafts by stealing data off the Australian servers on the US-based F-35 jets. So what should be GOLS stance with USA and Australia on this, since USA is going all out with MH-60R and F-35 promotion for Indian Armed Force? Fifth question, Rahul Vanketia, if I'm not wrong his name. BJP talks of taking back Akshay Shin. Is it practically possible? All right.
Okay.
Yes, sir. That's so much. Yeah.
Shall we answer this and then we'll.
Yes, sir. Yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah. I think so. Right. The first question which came up is China a communist nature, a communist system, or a fascist system? I think Xi Jinping has answered it himself. He's very clearly said he's going back to the Marxist principle. And they're going back to hardcore communism. So I don't think we need to discuss that also. Of course, fascism is part of the story. Whether you call it communism, fascism, authoritarianism, it's all the same. Okay. As far as our issue of taking back Akshay Chin, hand-to-hand fighting and things like that. Look, we have a situation. Okay. We don't have the capability today to take back Akshay Chin. It's just not there. We have to accept it. We don't have the capability from many points of view. We don't have the capability from infrastructure point of view. We don't have the capability from political point of view, economic point of view, or for that matter, military point of view. Today, all you have capability is hold China where it is. That capability we have. China can't make headway. Right? The one great advantage we had was experience, and that experience will see us through to hold China off. So we should be happy to keep China at arm's length and do a few minor things. If you want to go across and take Akshay Chin, we must remember Akshay Chin in its entirety depth is about over 100 kilometers. You're looking at major operations and major capabilities. And if you have to take over Akshay Chin, if I may spend a minute, you have to make China look inwards into Tibet. You have to hybridize it. It can't be a military adventure. You have to create chaos in Tibet and Xinjiang, if you have to get into Akshay Chin. Now, whether our leadership is up to it or not is a difficult question. Because we also must understand that we are a democracy to the extreme. We've had communist governments. We've had communist party part of our national government. They don't run off. You have religious government, governments based on religion. You have communal-based parties. You have ideological-based parties. In this kind of a plethora, for a democracy of our nature to stand up and have a clear-cut definition against China is going to be a difficult affair. At least in my life, and I'm sure all of us who are 60-plus or even 50-plus will understand this, it is for the first time that this government, good, bad or ugly, is taking a stand against China. We never took it in 62. It didn't come to that level in 67. It's only now, right, that we are able to take a stand and do something. And now there's a realization, national realization coming in, that we have to, this thing. So if we as a people depend on our governments to do everything for us, I don't think we'll go anywhere. I think it has to be a people's affair. Whoever comes in, like we keep saying over and over and again, and drill it into our government and stiffen the government's spine to stand. Right. And as far as China is concerned, China will thieve from anywhere, whether it's from Australia, USA, everywhere. And like Commodore Vasan said, we don't have the strength to take on China on our own. I don't think anyone today has the strength to take on China on their own. Even USA doesn't have the strength. So it has to be through a partnership. It has to be through an alliance. Call it alliance, partnership. You have to do it with someone else. It has to be to a multiple strategy. Right? And the way I look at it, EU, Australia, UK, and USA are going to come in. Part of ASEAN has also come back behind you, Japan. Right? And there's a growing realization as things go that China has to be contained. And I think it will happen. And we have to be part of that game and not apart from that game. We have to look at it a little more strategically. I think I've taken on all the questions. Any more questions? Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. There are a few more.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes. What effort should India put in to sway Cambodia, Philippines, Malaysia, and Brunei to a more neutral stance in SCS rather than depending heavily on China in military aspects?
Yeah, okay. I must answer you. If you go to Cambodia, I've been to Cambodia, you will see everything is Chinese there. Okay, you have no foothold in Cambodia. Brunei is very small. It's almost insignificant. So what are you looking at as Philippines? You're looking at Malaysia. You're looking at Indonesia. These three have, and Vietnam. Vietnam is our ledge there. We can leverage these four countries to go against China or take a stance against China. They can't take an open stance against China, right? But they can hold China at bay. Then you have some hope. Okay, and that won't come out of straight things. For that, the Chinese economy has to be downsized. And people say, and if you look into the future, that this economy is going to flatten out in the next 5 to 10 years after this. It's at its peak now. Maybe after 2025, it's going to start going down for many reasons. So that's when we can. But if you think we're going to go and leverage, these countries to do something in South China Sea, I don't think we can. We can't. If we also have to remember, USA couldn't. When USA 4 years back was more powerful, they had military equations with many of these countries, and yet China built their islands. What can India go and do in South China Sea? And to be very honest, there's a view which says we should go waving our flag in South China Sea. I think we should stick to Indian Ocean and be stable where we are. Yeah, next question.
Yes, sir. Talking of civil-military relations, what role will the new CDS and joint commands play in India?
Repeat the question, it got...
Yes, sir. Talking of civil-military relations, what role will the new CDS and joint commands play in India?
Yeah, look... As far as civil-military equations are concerned, I think the CDS and the joint commands have a huge role to play. Personally, I feel this is only a baby step which has been taken, CDS coming in, the political ones coming in and all that. Again, this is not a straight question. The fundamental problem with our system is that the political hierarchy is hands-off with the military. That's what it's been. If you see, go back to Clausewitz. Clausewitz said politics is war by other means and war is politics by other means. That means the politicians and the military people have to have a one-to-one connect and move ahead in any country. But in our country, that has not happened. The bureaucracy has interposed itself between the politicians and the military people. So there's no clarity of thought as to what the politicians want and what the military wants. They're not on one page. And the politicians, for whatever reason, for many reasons, have been happy to give this thing away to the bureaucracy. Well, the bureaucracy, I'm not blaming the bureaucracy, if they're bad, good or ugly. But the fact is that it's not the job in a state. They're supposed to run the state, not govern the state and not lay down policy. So they've not done it. So as a result, we are floundering. How does the CDS and the joint system rectify that is a challenge before us, right? Will the politicians rise up and take command of the system or take the system by the scruff of his neck is a question. In fact, I've written two articles on this. The articles are Theatrization, Are We Ready? And I've also examined the Goldwater-Nichols Act, by which the Americans reformed. If you look at the American system, the president has direct president, the RM, that the defense secretary, and the theater commands are in one line. That's a command channel. The joint chief of staff is in the staff channel. He's separate. I think we have a long way to go. And more important than all this, we need to get jointness in. unless we get jointness in, it's going to be a difficult affair. I'm not too optimistic on how things are going to move. We're going to have a rocky road ahead. Yeah.
Sir, can you please share your thoughts on reports of China's use of microwave weapons against India?
Yeah, I have written an article on it. It's a fake news. Okay. I mean, technically, it's not feasible in that place. You see, microwave weapons, again, please read my article. I've explained in detail technologically how it's not feasible. But to give you an answer, microwave weapons, you know, which China says it possesses, has a range of 80 meters. Okay. 80 meters is so close. It is like, you know, one end of the street to the other. It's less than that in any normal street in Chennai. And you're looking at a microwave at 18,000 feet, 20,000 feet down from one hilltop to the other, where hilltops itself are 8 to 9 kilometers apart or 4 to 5 kilometers apart minimum, where even eyeball to eyeball contact is not you won't be standing 200 meters away. You are standing more than 300 to 400 meters away at every place along the LSC. At that place, to say that I'm going to get a microwave weapon and, you know, scare Indians is very funny. It doesn't happen. And if you see a microwave weapon system, it needs a huge antenna, it's a huge vehicle. And to get that vehicle up to 18,000 feet, I don't know how they'll do it. But that's, I think that's part of the public opinion and, you know, that what I said, the dark strategies. That's it. Scare you into thinking something. One. Number two, nothing happened. If something like that happened, the injuries would have been different. The casualties would have been different. And in our system, those casualties couldn't have been hidden. It would have come out. We had nothing. So I think it's a fake. I don't think it's a fake. I'm convinced it's a fake. Yeah.
Okay. Next question is, are we not serving Chinese interests by projecting them to be bigger than their size? If China were to project our intentions, they could be talking the same our intentions on Xinjiang, Tibet, and so on. Our only problem, like any other democracy, being that Chinese can give money to consultants in India and abroad to carry out disruptions here. But that will assume that our intelligence agencies are not being watchful. Your comments, sir?
Yeah. At the outset, I've never said China is great. I said China is doing a lot of things. If you see all, like what Commodore Watson said, you see all my articles. I've said how China can be defeated and why China is not great. I've proven it. What are the myths of China? In my own personal view, China is, in about 10 years' time, China is going to struggle because they're aging. They're aging twice as fast as Japan did when Japan started stagnating. They don't have a retirement pension. You know, their major problem is not going to be military. Their major problem is going to be social. They have a 1-2-4 system. What is this 1-2-4 system? There's one guy who's working. He has to support his parents and his parents' parents, and his grandparents. So one guy who's working has to support six people. And all these six people don't have pensions because the pension system in China is the worst. And there are protests in China these days, which I read in South China Morning Post last week only about this problem. So they have a major, major problem and their birth rates are gone down and their replacement rates can't go up. People are not getting married. Women are not getting married. They have a surplus of men. We've heard reports of, you know, brides being sent from Pakistan to China, right? They're not having children. Even if you have two children, the whole effort is going to come out after 24, 25 years, a quarter of a century. It's proven that their population is going to stagnate. One, their dependency ratios are going to increase. If their dependency ratios are going to increase, the number of people who are going to work are going to decrease. Their economy has to stagnate or go down. There's no choice. Right? Plus, they're going to spend a whole lot on military. It's going to suck their system out. And energy. If you analyze China more, China is an energy deficient nation by any standards, right? So I don't say that China is great. I analyze China to see what it's trying. Unfortunately, many of us who don't understand China think it's great. And there are many ways to defeat China. The most simplest way is, you know, put Tibet, Mongolia, Hong Kong, and Xinjiang on fire, and China will come to its knees. It will come to its knees. Only thing we need to have the courage to do that. Yeah.
Sir, what is the name of the book on unrestricted war that was written by two Chinese generals?
It's called Unrestricted War. The book itself is called Unrestricted War.
Thank you, sir.
The way to defeat America or something like that. Yeah.
The next question, sir, is Tibet a good card for New Delhi to use to take on Beijing right now?
Tibet, Xinjiang, Mongolia, Hong Kong, and Taiwan, all these five are as good a cards as any other the way you exploit it. Right? We have to remember that the temporal power of the Tibetans is sitting in India, Dalai Lama. He's old, he might go, that's okay. But the next guy will also be here. The premier in exile is here, Lobsang Sangay. Right? Now you have to exploit it. You have a Tibetan settlement, you've given them land in Mysore. If you can't exploit this, and everyone knows it, we've been having them from 1957 when Dalai Lama ran away and came to India through Kenzamane. So if you can't exploit it, who else will? Right? So I think Tibet is a huge card and Tibet is a major weakness of China. And we need to exploit it for the simple reason we are going to have problems otherwise. If you don't put Tibet in problems, you're going to have this massive gorilla sitting on our border trying to suck water off Tsangpo. If water from Tsangpo is drained off, 50% of the water which is coming into the Brahmaputra basin can be controlled. If you study the Brahmaputra basin, about 30% of water comes from Tsangpo and about 20% of water comes from the Lohit. The other 30-50% comes from own side of the watershed. If you're going to control this and Lohit, which comes from, the Yunnan province, you're sunk. And if the 50% of water from Brahmaputra is denuded, you are in a major, major problem. My generation won't see it. Maybe the next generation and the next generation, the ecological damage which is going to be in Assam and those northeastern states is huge. And of course, Bangladesh. So you have no choice but to do something against Tibet. Otherwise, the buggers will construct dams. So we don't have a choice. Only thing is, when will our politicians understand this and start doing something along with China, along with USA? Because USA is going to do it one way or the other. They have already started the game. It's up to us. In fact, we don't have a choice. That's the way I look at it.
Yes,
I mean, just to put things in perspective, you look at Pakistan. 2 years back, Pakistan was a pain for us. Today, Pakistan doesn't have money. It's got a begging bowl. The PDM has holding rallies all around. Okay, all kinds of funny things are happening in Pakistan. And Pakistan is happy internalizing. There's one odd attack goes on, something happens and nothing else. Nothing is. Even the Saudis have got fed up of this fellow. The OIC is fed up of Kashmir. Kashmir is a dead horse. You can keep flogging it. We'll keep flogging it for many other reasons. But is it a dangerous horse? No more. Unless you make China internalize, Pakistan also internalize, you're going to have a problem. Another way of making, getting a hold on China is hit Pakistan. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Ramani Hariharan has asked, can Quad be a model for us to follow in multi-dimension war?
I agree with him completely. What Colonel Hariharan said, I think Quad is the way forward. But Quad has problems. Because I was speaking to an Australian ex-minister. In their concept, I'm just talking about Australia. It applies to all. Australia is a trading nation. Unless they trade, they can't survive. So they will continue trading with China. So is Japan. And they're part of the RCEP. Right? virtually by joining RCEP and by virtue of the fact that they have to trade with China, the economic impact of Quad is gone. They are not prepared to do. The sense I got from Australia was they're prepared to be a strategic, a political, or a security kind of a grouping. So much depends you, and we don't have any leverage on Australia to come with us. In fact, if you go back 10 years back, it was Australia who walked out of Quad. Japan, where will it go with the new premier is to be seen. It was one thing with Abe, whether Suga will go through with it, we don't know. Again, there is a lot of uncertainty with what President Biden will do. I think after 2-3 months, things will crystallize. Maybe February, March, things will crystallize. Till then, I'll put it the other way around. Quad itself is at a danger of being collapsed. That's the problem we have. Will Quad itself exist 4 months later is a question. Existential problem for Quad is the issue. So we have to see where we go. Any other question, please?
Yes, sir. D.S. Murugan Yadav has asked, what's your take on India's land warfare doctrine? At present, do we have any strategic framework to address the colossal threat, multi-domain threats, or to deal with its implications?
Yeah, that's a good question. We have a doctrine that we've been following. A lot of people criticize it. I'm okay with it. A lot of people say we fight very conventionally, and we are not capable of hybrid warfare A, B, C, D, E. First class. What does history tell you? Or history? Pakistan, we've had 4 wars, we've defeated them. Every war. Which they initiated at their time and their place of choosing. Look at China. Except 62, when, you know, you leave 62 out of the equation because it's too far back and, you know, for many reasons. 67, Doklam, Eastern Ladakh. We've taught them a military lesson. I mean, people will say, no, they've got some land, they have all that. But look, we are the only country who's held them on a leash. Everywhere else, even America stayed back in South China Sea. We are the only people who held them. Why China came to heel was because we occupied the Kailash Range. We are the only country who... We are handling a collusive threat. Okay, everyone says collusive threat. Look at it. Take your mind to Kashmir. We pumped in 2-3 divisions inside JNK. In addition to what we have. What is the threat we pose? Those 2-3 divisions, if things cool off, can go east or west. So it's collusive threat is a defensive frame of mind. My way of looking at it is, now that you put 3 divisions there, don't come back. Keep that. Tie Pakistan down. Tie China down. Let China commit itself to LC warfare, which it doesn't have experience on. Let it commit itself additional troops there, which it doesn't have. If you take addition, subtraction of the Chinese forces, China does not have infantry. That's the fundamental. They might have a big navy. And if you don't hold these mountains, that navy will expand. So let's not run away with the idea that we are doing nothing with a land doctrine or air doctrine or a naval doctrine. India has a very good sense of what it is doing. Right? We might not have codified it the way Westerners have done or Chinese have done, but we do what we are necessary to do. After all, most of us who have fought wars right from old time to now will tell us we know how to sort out Pakistan and China. It's not a great deal. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Due to time constraint, I'll stop here.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you so much. Yes.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for all those lovely questions. I hope I've been convincing in answering all this. I must tell you, in certain circles, I'm considered a hawk. And I'm proud to be so. Right. I am of the opinion that if you study China well, you know how to hit them hard. Right? There's no doubt about it. I have no doubt at all. Right? And I am very grateful that all of you have taken time to listen to me and listen to my rambling about China. I am personally grateful to General K.R. Rao, who's taken time off. He was my DGRT and he taught me a lot. I've served thrice under him and he was the one who made a general out of me. And I'm also thankful to Mr. Jayant Patil, the whole time director of L&T, who's made it a point to come and listen to me. We, of course, go back a long way. I must tell you, it's very great that, you know, L&T has taken an interest in us, in our talks. Mr. Patil has taken L&T Defense to be the biggest firm in India, defense firm. I would say, and it's the budding multinational, the way I look at it. And I have a long association with them. I've had the privilege of inducting the K-9 Vajra through L&T and the Pinaka rocket systems through the L&T. They're doing a great job for the nation. Thank you, Mr. Patil, for being there. And thank you, Rao, sir, for being
Thank you, General. Always thank pleasure you. Hearing you. Thank you, General Shankar. I think that was an outstanding Sunday that we've had. We had more than 50 people who come here. And I'm very happy to see, you know, your old colleagues join us, as General Rao and Mr. Patil and others who are here. It adds a lot of value. I'm sure we'll continue to interact with them. So, you know, there are very positive things that you brought out in terms of how we need to understand China better. So that, you know, we don't, you know, I keep on saying this in all the forums. We don't have to look at him as a 12-foot tall giant. You know, look at him in the eye, assess him properly, and have your counters. I think when Xi took over in 2013, the message was very clear. He said, go and tell the Chinese story. What he meant was the Chinese story of success is what is to be sold around the world. And many countries have fallen for this, which is why, you know, there was initial success on the BRI, because everybody said it's a great thing to happen, you know, where you can add to your infrastructure, you know, and all of them forgot about the tech trap, which was there. So from that point of view, we had a very interesting session this morning. I'd like to thank you on behalf of C3S and all the members who are present here. And I'm sure we'll have more such interactions in the future. And thank you also for putting us in touch with, you know, the veterans who are here today with us. We'll also reach out to them so that they can come and contribute to our understanding of China. I heard Mr. Patil, when he came down to address us in the CII, it was a joint conference some time ago. And, you know, it was a pleasure to hear him because, you know, here was one company which was contributing not just to Arihant, but also in terms of our shipbuilding, our repair facilities. And in fact, the L&T here did a wonderful job of delivering ships ahead of time, you know, which was unheard of in the past. So the Coast Guard vessels that were built here in Kattupalli, you know, came out way ahead of time. So I'm very happy that, you know, this group is expanding and we've had some very interesting discussions today. And special thanks to General Shankar for accepting our invitation to be part of C3S. You know, he brings a lot of value addition in terms of being a hawk. Let me say that. We are very happy that we have hawks amongst us. We need some hawks and not doves. So thank you so much. And over to Bala for the formal word of thanks. And thank you all for being with us. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Commodore Vasan, sir, for the concluding remarks. Thank you, Lieutenant General Shankar, sir. We definitely have understood a lot. The concept of war is ever-growing and getting more complicated, including all pervasive.
Bala, 1 minute. Huh? You don't mind. One minute. I must also thank my sister, who's tuned in from Bombay. Right? This is the first time probably she's seen me talking.
I was just wondering, Rajeshwari Pali.
Rajeshwari, she's my younger sister. Thanks for listening. Yeah, please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Definitely, we have understood a lot that wars in future could well remain unannounced in non-kinetic format, and they can even be successful in achieving the political goals with or without transcending to force-on-force war. With this, I would like to call upon Ms. Aishwarya, Research Officer C3S, to present the formal vote of thanks. Over to you, Aishwarya.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon to one and all. It gives me immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks in the conclusion of the C3S Institutional Dialogue on China's Multi-Domain Warfare, which proved to be both insightful as well as thought-provoking. At the outset, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to our speaker for the day, Lieutenant General P.R. Shankar, for accepting our invitation to share his input.